mientras la doctora Charabal tiene un aviso parroquial que queda en el contenido así, si alguien es dueño de un vehículo con placa Apache GR025, no sé si es de la puerta, que por favor se me dice que se lo van a llevar, que tenga la placa.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the organizers for having me. I'm very happy. This is my first visit to Colombia, and I have to say that I'm falling in love with your city. We had a tour yesterday that really highlighted what an amazing city this is, and a city of resilience and hope and enthusiasm and just beautiful energy. So I'm very excited to be here and very excited to be in the company of fantastic women in GI. Of Dr. Pilar Nos and Dr. Diana Parra, so thank you for welcoming me. So my goal today, this is not working. My goal today is to talk about de-escalating therapies in inflammatory bowel disease. We're focusing on thiopurine and anti-TNF. Okay, so my goal today is to talk about de-escalating therapies in patients with inflammatory bowel disease, really focusing on thiopurine and anti-TNF. So we reviewed together the data on thiopurine and anti-TNF de-escalation, and I really want us to understand which patients with inflammatory bowel disease are actually the right candidate for therapy de-escalation. And like Dr. Pilarnos was saying, the most important thing when we're treating escalating or de-escalating is to really monitor our patient and make sure that they are not flaring when we de-escalate. Okay, so Dr. Pilarnos already went over this, but I think it's important to think about de-escalation within those treatment goals, which are to keep the patient in clinical and endoscopic remission, prevent complications such as surgery, cancers, strictures, etc., and also allow the patient to have a good quality of life and prevent disability in the context of inflammatory bowel disease. So when we choose a treatment, we choose it depending on the severity, the activity of the disease, the patient characteristics, and periodically we need to monitor the patient and assess whether or not we achieve these goals. If we did not achieve them, it's important to reassess the treatment dose, frequency, or the mechanism of action. If we achieve clinical endoscopic remission, then we maintain the patient on that therapy. And these are the patients that could become a candidate for de-escalation. Patients who have been in sustained clinical and endoscopic remission on a stable dose of medication without the need of steroids. All right, so while we're talking about de-escalation, one is needing to prevent complications. We know that on combination therapy, especially with thiopurine and anti-TNF, there's a high risk of infection, high risk of lymphoma, and skin cancer. Also, many of the populations we're treating are at higher risk for these specific complications. So young men are at higher older patient at high risk of infection and then lymphoma on combination therapy. Patients who are at high risk of tuberculosis or infections, we need to minimize those risks in these patients. Also, some of these therapies can have effect on other medical conditions the patients can have, heart disease, clotting, etc. And also, it's important to think about costs. IBD is on the rise in every country, and so reducing costs by reducing the number of medication that's needed to keep the patient in remission is important to think. And of course, I'm sure every one of you have had patients coming in and saying, I'm doing well, can I stop my medication, or can I stop one of my medications? So often patients prefer to use less medication for their disease. So I'm going to walk you through different case scenarios, and we'll see what the data shows. So if your patient is on azathioprine monotherapy, doing well in clinical remission for at least 3 years, and then you stop azathioprine, what happens? In this study, it shows us that within 2 years, 30 to 40% of patients will re-flare, and more than one-third of these flare are moderate to severe. And after 5 years, around 50% of patients will re-flare of azathioprine. But the good news is that we are able to capture response in most of these patients if you give them a course of steroids and restart azathioprine. How about in patients on combination therapy of infliximab and a full dose of azathioprine? Can you reduce azathioprine or can you stop it? So this study looked at three groups. Group A are patients who were kept on azathioprine and infliximab. Group B are patients who were kept on infliximab, but azathioprine dose was decreased by half. And in group C, they were kept on infliximab, but azathioprine was completely discontinued. Again, these were patients that were doing well on combination therapy and who were in clinical and endoscopic remission for more than 6 months. So let's see what happens. If we decrease the dose of azathioprine by half, actually patients do very well. They do as well as the patients that were kept on full dose of azathioprine and infliximab. Relapse rate are the same. The risk of developing antibody to infliximab is the same, and the infliximab trough level remains the same. So, but one other thing to note is that if the level of CTG, which is the active metabolite of azathioprine, goes below 100 in those patients where we decrease the dose of azathioprine, then these patients were at high risk of developing antibody to infliximab. So keep that in mind. So what happens if you stop completely azathioprine? This is where we get our patients in trouble. 30% of these patients will relapse within a year. And this is likely due to the fact that by stopping azathioprine, we are increasing the risk of developing antibody. 53% of these patients develop antibody to infliximab. And subsequent to that, the level of infliximab dropped. So these patients on combination therapy, when we stop azathioprine completely, we put them at risk of developing antibody to infliximab, developing low drug level, and developing a flare. So I think the lesson we can learn here are a few things. One is before decreasing or stopping azathioprine, it's important to check infliximab drug level and to check for antibodies. Maybe the first step is to decrease azathioprine dose by half before stopping it. And again, repeat that monitoring that Dr. Pilanos was talking about. We check infliximab level, we check for antibody, and maybe adjust the dose of infliximab before completely stopping azathioprine. And this is actually, to highlight this point. It's very important to look at the infliximab level before we stop azathioprine. So in the dark black, our patients whose infliximab level before stopping azathioprine combination, infliximab level was undetectable. In blue, our patients who had an infliximab level that's detectable but less than 5, and in bright turquoise, our patients whose infliximab level was above 5. And what we see here, so if you take those patients on infliximab and azathioprine, and you stop azathioprine, if that drug level before stopping azathioprine was undetectable, when we stop azathioprine, basically those patients have no medication in their body. And so they inflate. The chances of remaining in remission on infliximab alone is close to zero. and these are patients that would need to have their dose adjusted. If the patient had an infliximab level above 5 before stopping azathioprine, they will continue to do well after several years and will not flare. And of course, if they have a level somewhere in between, then we have in between result, and they usually need adjustment of infliximab dosing and frequency to keep them in remission. All right, how about stopping infliximab? Right. We talked about stopping azathioprine. How about stopping infliximab? Infliximab is often a more expensive drug, and there's an incentive to maybe stop it. Several patients are not able to go to infusion center, or it's inconvenient for them, it's affecting their work schedule. So can we stop infliximab? This is a stop it study that looked at Crohn's disease patients in clinical and endoscopic remission on a standard dose of infliximab for more than 1 year. Now, around 50% of these patients were also on immunomodulator. And what we see here in orange are patients who are kept on infliximab. 100% of them did well at the end of 1 year, no relapse. The patients who infliximab was stopped, 50% of them flared at 1 year, even if they had azathioprine or other immunomodulator on board. And this is very consistent with other retrospective and prospective studies showing that if you stop infliximab, even in patients who were on immunomodulator, kept on immunomodulator, those patients were at high risk of reflaring. Around 70 to 80% of these patients would reflare after 1 year, 5 years, or 7 years. So this is an interesting study looking at what is the best strategy. We show that if we stop azathioprine, we can flare. If we stop infliximab, we can flare. Which strategy gives us the less risk of flares and optimize our treatment care for the patient? So this first study looked at Crohn's patients who were on combination therapy for more than 8 months, infliximab, standard dosing, plus either azathioprine or methotrexate. They were on steroid-free remission for more than 6 months. And they were randomized to either continue combination therapy or stop infliximab or stop antimetabolite. So let's see what strategy is the best strategy. So you see here in black are those who stopped the antimetabolite. They did as well as those in orange who kept the combination therapy. So the risk of flares after more than a year, after 2 years, was similar between the two groups. Those two groups did well. However, if we stop infliximab, so in turquoise, our patients who stopped infliximab and kept the metabolite, 50% or 60% of them flared. The good news is that in this patient population, if we put infliximab back on board, we are able to recapture response and achieve remission. So from this data, if your patient is on combination therapy, the best strategy if you want to stop one medication is to stop the antimetabolite, not infliximab. And this is again very similar to other retrospective and prospective studies showing that we can resume infliximab after stopping it. So these are studies looking at patients that stopped infliximab, and then when they flared, infliximab was resumed, and more than 80% of patients went back in remission without infusion reaction. Which is interesting because the question is, we all know that if we stop infliximab for a long period of time, patients are at high risk of developing antibody against infliximab, and then if you want to use it again, you can. So it's very important to recognize that all these studies select for a subpopulation of patients that don't develop antibody to infliximab. So we know that antibody to infliximab typically develop in the first year of using infliximab. And if we use immunomodulator, we prevent the development of antibody to infliximab. And in all these trials, it's important to remember that all these are patients who are on infliximab and immunomodulator for at least 1 year before infliximab was stopped. So these are patients that are not at high risk of developing antibody. And so these are the patients also that were kept on immunomodulator once infliximab was stopped. So when you resume infliximab, they don't have antibody to respond. So the point here is that if you have a patient on infliximab only and you stop it, that patient might not be the right one to go back on infliximab because they're at high risk of developing antibody. If you had a patient on combination therapy from the start, and you stopped infliximab and you kept it to the prior period, these are patients not at risk of having antibody and you can resume infliximab. So I want to end with a few things. Like Dr. Durano said, it's very important to choose the right therapy in the right patient at the right time. So it's very important to re-identify which patient is a candidate for de-escalation and also understand why you're doing that. So if you have a patient at high risk of complications from being on combination therapy, you want to consider de-escalation. These are your young men who are at high risk of hepatocellular T-cell lymphoma on combination therapy, your older patients who are at risk of infection and lymphoma and skin cancer, and often older patients have already history of cancer, so we want to de-escalate therapy. Also, you want to choose the patient who are at low risk of complication from the disease, and then you can de-escalate. So these are patients who have short disease duration before they start on biologic, short extensive disease, they never had fistula, suture, surgery, they don't get hospitalized, they have not required multiple courses of prednisone, they have not required multiple therapy before you finally stabilize them. So choose the right patient for de-escalation. So this is how I do it in my practice. When patient asks me, can I stop medication? My first reflex is no, we cannot stop all medication. So stopping all medication should be discouraged. We need to choose one medication to keep on board to maintain remission. It's a reasonable choice to de-escalate, and we should follow a certain criteria. One, clinical remission alone is not enough. We have to make sure that the patient is in endoscopic healing before de-escalating. We have to be sure that the patient is in stable remission, clinical endoscopic remission of steroid for at least a year, in my opinion. Then it's important to discuss with the patient what would you do in case they re-flare when you de-escalate. So you have to agree with the patient ahead of time. If you re-flare, we will put this drug back on, or we would start this kind of therapy. So have a strategy in place in case the patient re-flare. Now, if your patient is on thalidomide monotherapy, like we showed, if we stop it, one third of this patient will develop a flare, but we can recapture the response. So, you know, most patients will not be flared if we stop their thalidomide. So I think if your patient is on thalidomide monotherapy and they wish to stop for whatever reason, we can stop it, monitor, if they reflare, put them back on thalidomide. If your patient is on an anti-TNF monotherapy, check for drug level. If your drug level is very high, you can decrease the dose, space the frequency, so that you keep them well with a lower drug level. If your patient is on combination therapy, I check drug level. If the anti-TNF is very high, then I feel confident that I can stop azathioprine or decrease the dose of azathioprine by half, and again, I monitor the anti-TNF level. If the anti-TNF level is not detectable, it means the azathioprine is doing all the work. Then I stop the anti-TNF and I keep the azathioprine. Finally, if the anti-TNF is at a good level and we plan to stop it, we know the patient is going to relapse, but we know that we can recapture response if we keep them on immunomodulator. So best strategy, in my opinion, if you're on combination therapy with good anti-TNF level, is to stop the azathioprine, keep the anti-TNF on board, monitor the patient clinically with biomarker by endoscopy, and monitor your drug level, because you might need to increase your dose of frequency of anti-TNF to keep that drug level where it should be. Thank you very much for your attention.